the luck of the draw, breaking your leg, your fears of cancer, and a gun in your house. Randomness, statistics, and luck on Science Without Walls. Life is statistical. Science is statistical. Much of science is based on randomness and probability. The oxygen molecules you are breathing in right now, passing through your lung membranes and into the hemoglobin of your red blood cells, are the same molecules which had been bouncing randomly in the air. Molecular motions, lottery winners, and evolution are all largely statistical. A random mutation in DNA, one nucleotide change, results in a code for a different amino acid in the particular protein coded by that DNA. A different amino acid, a different protein. A different protein, different properties. Different properties, different characteristics. Perhaps better characteristics, perhaps worse. Millions, billions, and trillions of random mutations, throws of the DNA dice, weighted, filtered by Darwin's natural selection, brought us to Homo sapiens, to you and me. The drive into school or work along one of Utah's rapidly congesting highways, a chance unpredictable action by you or by some other driver, and another accident statistic. Unintentional, unpredictable. Partially your fault if you were distracted or otherwise not driving attentively or defensively. You may be the best, most careful, most attentive, most defensive driver in the world, and it could still happen because of statistics, randomness, probability, bad luck. Life is statistical. Insurance is statistical. You probably have some life insurance. You're betting that you're going to die. If you do, the insurance company pays your beneficiary. The insurance company is actually betting that you're going to live. Insurance companies understand statistics and probability better than any other part of our society. They make their money on statistics. Other people who understand statistics are those who run the casinos, the lotteries, and others who encourage us to gamble. The difference is that when you gamble, in Las Vegas or Wendover, you are gambling. They are not. They have engineered, they've adjusted the odds so they always win, statistically. The casino rarely, if ever, loses. Slot machines are not random. Sure, they may have a 97% payback, but that other 3%, statistically, never comes back. So on the average, the only people who make money in Wendover or Vegas are those who own the casinos. Yes, you may hit it big, and people do, but most everybody else loses. Their losses pay your winnings, and of course pay the profit made by the casinos and the lotteries. Yes, some of the profit goes to pay for the staff, which provides jobs, and that's good. And in the case of state or public lotteries, what is left over is generally used for some public function, like education or museums. But if all the money put into lottery tickets was put directly into education or into museums, it would be a lot more. But it's more fun to take your chances in Wendover or Idaho. Maybe you'll be lucky just this once, but the odds are you won't. You don't see stories in the papers about the millions who lost their money in lottery tickets. This one is made up. You do see stories about the one who won. The 1 million or so who each lost is not news. The one who won is news. That's just the way the media operates, because that's what you want to hear or read. You identify with that one person who won, and not with the million who lost. You're not alone. Most of us are that way. That's why the media is completely unrepresentative. In a sense, completely dishonest, because the whole story is rarely presented. Another, less direct aspect of statistics is borrowing money. Credit requires interest. A wise authority has said, "Them's that understands it earns it, them's that don't pays it." When you borrow, you're betting that you will be able to pay the loan back on schedule. You have to pay a rental fee called interest for the use of that money until you pay it back. The major difference in renting money as opposed to renting goods is that you normally rent the money, borrow the money, to spend it, to purchase other things and to pay other bills. The money is gone. There is no money to pay back. It's very unlike renting a car. When you're finished with your rental car, it's still there, so it's easy to give it back. It's often not easy to give back borrowed money. You have to earn more money in order to pay it back. So you're gambling that you'll be able to earn the money needed to pay back what you owe and also to pay the interest on what you owe, the rental fee. If you're unsuccessful in doing that, then you've accumulated even more debt and started to develop a bad credit rating. Credit cards are a great convenience if you're fiscally and financially responsible. But the credit card companies don't only make their money from the small percentage on each transaction paid by the merchant. In the fine print of every credit card is, of course, the interest rate. If you don't pay your monthly bill on time, you have to pay what is among the highest interest rate in the nation for borrowed money, about 18% annually. The average household has four credit cards with a total debt of nearly $5,000 at a rental fee of 18%. We all have debts. Even if your car and all your personal stuff is paid for, you have a major debt. As a citizen of the United States, you have a personal debt of about $20,000. You are personally responsible, as one of 260 million Americans, for 1/260,000,000th of our national debt, which now stands at about $5 trillion, increasing by several hundred billion each year. So our federal government is also addicted to credit. We don't take in enough in taxes and other income to pay all of the federal expenditures. So the federal government borrows. It borrows from you and me. It borrows from major banks, from major investors, and from a lot of overseas investors who see U.S. debt as a fairly good bet. Every federal dollar spent includes a chunk of borrowed dollars, and we have to pay interest for that borrowed money. When you accumulate a lot of debt, the interest really begins to add up. The debt continues to accumulate, continues to grow. We discussed exponential functions before. Remember, bacteria and people grow exponentially, and often so does debt. If bacteria have the space and the nutrients, they can grow and multiply every 20 to 30 minutes. The doubling time for human population, assuming no dramatic famines, diseases, or other constraints, is now down to about 25 years. Interest on debt is also an exponential function. If you continue to accumulate debt, then your total debt, of course, increases. As that total debt increases, your total money rental, the interest, also increases. It can increase to a level or amount which becomes very difficult to deal with, just as it has with the federal government. If you don't pay that interest and those bills, your car is repossessed, your TV set may be repossessed, and if you're paying on a house, that too may be repossessed. This ad is a good example of a very popular modern gamble, the home equity loan. Let's assume that you bought a house. You've been paying on it for some time, maybe 10 years. You think you own part of it, but you don't. You don't own any of it until the full debt is paid. Until then, if you fail to make those payments, the bank can come in and repossess, take away the entire house. you would then be one of the homeless on the street. Now, we have banks running around asking you to borrow money on the equity in your home. They're called home equity loans. They encourage people to gamble what is, in most cases, their major asset. In this ad, they're suggesting you use the loan for unneeded, unnecessary, essentially superfluous stuff. Furniture, diamond rings, recreational vehicles. So you sign over the equity on your home to this bank in exchange for this loan that you probably do not need. If you make your mortgage payments but don't pay back the home equity loan, the loan company can take your home. It's gone. You have become homeless. Of course, you could pawn the diamond ring and sell the recreational vehicle, but I assure you, you'll lose money in that process. It's a gamble. Gambling is statistics and probability. Statistics and probability have very simple rules. Those rules are used throughout many areas of mathematics and throughout most of the sciences. Those same rules are the fundamental basis of much of economics, including bank loans and insurance policies. There are two four-letter words in our vocabulary that are greatly misused by the advertising and credit industries. The words need and want. There are certain things you need: food, shelter, medical care, companionship. And there are many things you may want. Listen very carefully to ads, because they constantly tell you that you need what you want. The difference between need and want is intentionally confused or ignored in practically all advertising today. There's a wonderful message I had time to ponder in my dentist's office the other day. Happiness is not getting what you want, it's wanting what you have. It's good advice. Here's some more. A passage from this not very well-known book says it even more explicitly. Quote, "What does a man need, really need? A few pounds of food each day, heat and shelter, 6 feet to lie down in, and some form of working activity that will yield a sense of accomplishment. That's all, in the material sense, and we know it. But we are brainwashed by our economic system until we end up in a tomb beneath a pyramid of time payments, mortgages, preposterous gadgetry, playthings that divert our attention from the sheer idiocy of the charade." Unquote. That was from Sterling Hayden's 1963 book, Wanderer. Try to minimize the materialism trap. Let's move from buying stuff with money we don't have to another major area of statistics: risk. Life is inherently risky. There's risk all around us. Your house or apartment could crumble right now, perhaps because the Wasatch Front's huge Richter 7+ earthquake is finally here. Or perhaps because some airplane just happened to fall out of the sky right onto your place. Unlikely, but not impossible. Simply improbable. Your bad luck. A much greater risk, of course, is being involved in an auto accident on your way to work or school tomorrow. If you are an alert, attentive, safe driver, that risk is, of course, much lower than if you are a bad and careless driver. But the risk is never zero. There is always the possibility and the probability that you will be the unlucky one, the statistic. There's no point in worrying a great deal about it. That's just the way the world works. We can minimize those probabilities by means of our decisions and actions, but we can never completely eliminate them. Well, since so much of science, so much of our everyday lives is related to probability, to randomness, let's take a more detailed look at the bell curve, better called the normal distribution, which seems to govern much of the statistics in our world. Let's do an experiment. Take 10 pennies in a cup, shake and throw. Count the number of heads. Now do this 1,000 times and plot the result. You'll get this distribution function. 5 heads and 5 tails is the average, the most common result, but only 25% of the time. The other 75% of the throws don't give you 5 and 5. This is a typical normal or bell curve. Almost everything you measure in nature gives a similar curve. If we were to do this with the height of BYU students, it might range from under 5 feet to over 6 feet. There aren't any 8-footers or 3-footers. The majority of us are average, about 5.5 feet. Now, obviously, I could change the statistics, because any set of statistics, such as the ones you've just seen, depends on the population, the group from which the data were gathered. If I were to look at the distribution function for the height of professional NBA basketball players, you know that it's not going to peak or average around 5.5 feet. It peaks at about 207 centimeters, 81 inches, nearly 7 feet. But this is not a normal bell curve. It is skewed towards the taller end of the curve. It's a non-symmetrical distribution. So when you read the polls in the paper, when you read anything in the paper, don't ever take it too literally. You always have to go beyond the headlines, or certainly beyond the first paragraph, and ask yourself, what is really going on? Has this data or this population been selected? Another very important subject is risk, and this one is closely tied to perception. Perception is not only related to what we do with the physical and chemical information provided by our senses. Perception is also involved in dealing with a wide range of socio-political and psychological issues. Risk perception is particularly interesting and important. We all want to avoid risk. We do not intentionally fall down stairs, slip on the ice, or otherwise cause harm or injury to ourselves. And yet, those risks are all around us. We make hundreds, perhaps thousands, of decisions every day which relate to risk avoidance or risk acceptance. But almost no one objectively assesses their personal risks. There is a science of risk assessment. It's developed over the last 20 or so years. It says that you and I have a strategy for assessing risk, although the components of that strategy are often subconscious and not directly understood or appreciated. We apparently use the following criteria in assessing risk. Is it beyond our control? Examples here include global catastrophic events, such as a major devastating earthquake. Is it relatively unknown? Is there little experience or data, such as perhaps genetic engineering of new organisms? Is it readily observable and interpretable, often with well-known risks? Good examples are auto accidents. Is it voluntary or largely self-controllable, such as smoking, skiing, skydiving, even driving? Even if we have data and are told that risks are approximately the same, we perceive risks very differently based on these four criteria. Stuff which is uncontrollable and unknown is considered to be the greatest risk, the ones for which we demand protection by society. Those risks which are more common, more well-known, are accepted because of their commonness, especially if we have some voluntary choice or control over them. Risks that seem fairly shared are seen as more acceptable than those that are not. We perceive natural risks as less threatening than man-made ones, and risks from exotic or new technologies are more feared than those involving more familiar technologies. You're easily willing to take risks 1,000 times greater when you perceive them as being voluntary. Another way of saying this is, if it's an involuntary risk and you don't have much choice, you insist on it being over 1,000 times safer than those things which you might normally choose to do. So, just as you perceive the world non-objectively, based on your experience, your attitude, your mood, and a variety of other things, you also perceive statistics probability and risk the same way, non-objectively. Your risk perception is largely conditioned and controlled by what you have already learned or think you have learned, by familiarity or the lack of familiarity. Let's look at some risk numbers. Flying in the space shuttle is a very risky job. Senator Garn knew that. Here he responds to a question from KUED's Ken Verdoya on space shuttle risks.
Less than a year later,
the
space shuttle Challenger takes off from the Kennedy Space Center, designated, I believe, Shuttle Flight 51E, a flight that you were originally slated to be on until you were reassigned to 51D in April of 1985.
Engines throttling up, three engines now at 104%.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Have you played out in your mind what might have been if you were not reassigned? That was your mission? That may have been your fate?
I don't have any regrets or any fears about it, but I think something else you also have to remember is that there has never been a draftee on the space shuttle or in space flight. We've all been volunteers and we all wanted to go very badly. So you have a recognition that there are tens of thousands of things that can go wrong and you're going to be in a very hostile environment of the vacuum of space. My point is there is a recognition that there is danger, but not fear, or you wouldn't go.
All the astronauts know that, even if the press is surprised. Mountain climbing can be very risky, but it's a voluntary risk. You choose to do it or you don't. Skydiving is another good example. The greatest daily risk most of us face is being involved in an auto accident. One in 5,000 per year. That's pretty risky. If you're a pedestrian, that decreases by a factor of 5. It's much safer being a pedestrian. You also have about a 1 in 10,000 annual risk of having a significant accident in your own home. But in many parts of the country, your risk of getting shot is now approaching the number one risk, auto accidents. One of the riskiest occupations in society is no occupation at all. The riskiest occupation is to be unemployed. Being unemployed rates as the equivalent of smoking about 10 packs of cigarettes a day. Being very poor is just as risky. It's been reported that living in poverty reduces your life expectancy nearly 10 years. Severe emotional or psychological stress is generally far riskier than the physical risks we routinely face. Risk prediction is similar to dealing with the properties of individual molecules. Chemists and physicists can easily predict the behavior of large collections of molecules using their normal distribution averaging methods. But they cannot predict the behavior of that individual electron, atom, or molecule. Remember Heisenberg? His uncertainty principle always wins. Intrinsic uncertainty makes individual predictions impossible. Those same statistical problems or principles apply at the level of our individual risk. Insurance companies cannot predict whether you will be killed or injured in an accident, although they can accurately estimate the annual number of car-related deaths in the United States. When that statistical event happens to you, it can be the cause of great sorrow or great celebration. If it's winning the lottery or the jackpot at Wendover, then presumably it's cause for celebration. But if it's a senseless statistical event that results in great loss, then it seems so senseless. There is a lot we can do to minimize risk. Putting on our seat belts, driving carefully, alertly, defensively, walking carefully on the ice, wearing safety glasses. But we also have to understand, to appreciate, and even accept that rare, random, senseless events do happen. And when they do, if they were truly random, then it simply is no one's fault. Our legal system today Both the judges and the lawyers simply do not understand that. This lack of education and understanding of statistics, of randomness, of risk, coupled with a let's get rich quick or let's get someone to pay for it attitude, have led to an enormous level of litigiousness in our society, which is continuing to be of great concern. But that's another story. Question everything you see and read. Ask yourself, is this representative? Is this general? Is this reasonable? Or is this an isolated event, blown out of proportion? And remember, there is no such thing as zero risk of anything. Random events happen. Senseless, horrible events happen. And so do senseless, wonderful events. Good luck.
Luck be a lady tonight. Luck be a lady tonight. Luck if you've ever been a lady to begin with. Luck be a lady tonight. Luck let a gentleman see how nice a dame you can be. I know the way you've treated other guys you've been with. Luck be a lady with me. Be